Sarve, Sarve, Rupam, Rupam, Rishinha, Kindly give up
Manyum,
your your anger,
Asura,
Asura.
My father, Hiranyakashipu, the great demon.
My father, Hiranyakashipu, the great demon.
Cha,
also,
Ataha,
killed.
Toya,
by you,
Adya,
today.
Modeta,
take pleasure. Sadhu api,
even a saintly person.
Vrishchika sarva hatya,
by killing a snake or a scorpion.
Loka,
all the planets.
Indeed.
Pleasure.
Ita.
Have achieved.
Pratiyanti.
Awaiting.
For pacification of your anger.
Sarve.
All of them.
Rupam.
This form.
Nishinha.
O Lord Nishinhadev.
Vibhayaya.
Mitigating the fear.
Jana.
All the people of the universe.
Smaranti.
Will remember.
Translation. My Lord Nrisimhadev, please therefore cease your anger now that my father, the great demon Hiranyakashipu, has been killed. Since even saintly persons take pleasure in the killing of a scorpion or a snake, all the worlds have achieved great satisfaction because of the death of this demon. Now they are confident of their happiness, and they will always remember your auspicious incarnation in order to be free from fear. Prabhupada, the most important point in this verse is that although saintly persons never desire the killing of any living entity, they take pleasure in the killing of envious living entities like snakes and scorpions. Hiranyakashipu was killed because he was worse than a snake or a scorpion, and therefore everyone was happy. Now there was no need for the Lord to be angry. The devotees can always remember the form of Nrisimhadev when they are in danger, and therefore the appearance of Nrisimhadev was not at all inauspicious. The Lord's appearance is always worshipable and auspicious for all sane persons and devotees. Tatyacha manim asurascha tastrayadya Modeta sada vibhishtika sarva acha lokastha nivritimita pratiyanti sarve rupam nishinga vibhayaya janas maranti. My Lord Nrisimhadev, please therefore cease your anger now that my father, the great demon Hiranyakashipu, has been killed. Since even saintly persons take pleasure in the killing of a scorpion or a snake, all the worlds have achieved great satisfaction because of the death of this demon. Now they are confident of their happiness, and they will always remember your auspicious incarnation in order to be free from fear. Om Madhyamati Brandashakya Manasalakya Chaksuni Tamyena Tasmai Sri Kuruve Maha Mukham Karo Chivacha Rampam Nundanda Tekarim Yat Kriva Taham Nambe Sri Gurum Dhinacharinam Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Namne Namaste Saraswati Deva Gaurabhane Prachayane Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatyavadi Sathayane Vancha Kalpa Charubhyascha Kripa Sandhaveva Cha Patitnam Bhavane Vaishnavi Yo Namaha Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Sri Vasudeva Vrindavan Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram Hare Ram 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 Hare Hare. This verse here had a little significance to Prabhupada. There was an incident one time in the Sri Chaitanya Mart, Bhaktivinoda Saraswati's Mart Ashram temple in Sridhar Mayapur, very wonderful place. And Prabhupada, he was there visiting or staying, I'm not even sure exactly how So Prabhupada was there amongst with other devotees, and they were going about their business and talking, chanting, or something like that. And suddenly there was a snake. Suddenly a snake came crawling amongst everyone. Everyone was perplexed, you know, what to do, there's a snake here. And then Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, he came up on the balcony, and he saw what was going on, and then he saw the snake and said, kill it immediately, kill the snake immediately. And then someone went with the snake and killed it. At that time Prabhupada actually got a little doubt, you know, how is this, you know, like Guru Maharaj, such a great saintly person, now he orders this snake to be killed. Is this really right? So Prabhupada had some doubts like that. But then later on, then he came across this verse here and said, no, this is completely according to Shastra. That snakes and scorpions, they can be killed. And even saintly persons, they take pleasure in snakes and scorpions being killed. Of course, that doesn't mean that saintly persons, they start like having snake hunting parties going out in the forest, and, you know, that they search out snakes to kill them. Snakes also have their place in God's nature and God's order, and if they are just out there and don't bother anyone, at least don't bother us, don't bother any humans like that, then then they are allowed to have their place. And it's also said, just as a, as the opposite is that household has duty to feed everyone, even snakes in the house. That's another point for being a household. Prabhupada, he said, the main duty of the householder, and it was a disciple who asked him what is, a duty of a household. I've got married, so what is my duty as a householder? And Prabhupada said, your duty is that before you take your meals, you stand outside the door and you shout three times in all directions. Is anyone hungry? If so, please come and take food here. I have food for everyone. You call out three times like that. If nobody comes, then you can go and take your meal. Or if somebody comes, then you have to feed them. And so Prabhupada said like that to that that disciple, and then he decided. Okay, but otherwise, then he said, what is it? You know, what are my duties as a householder besides that? And then Prabhupada just repeated the same thing. You know, before you eat, before you have a meal, you step outside out in the door and call three times in all directions. If anyone is hungry, please come and eat. That is your duty as a householder. Charity is basically meant for householders. Giving charity, performing sacrifices, and self-control. As well, you know, these are some of the specific duties for householders. And feeding other is a duty of the household, and the household, not only people should be fed, but it's everyone. It's even animals should be fed. The dogs and the cats should also, they should not be hungry. And even the snakes, they should also be fed. That's actually Shastra instruction. But here we have some the other side. I mean, snakes can be killed, but that's, of course, goes because many snakes are not dangerous. They're poisonous snakes, and then there are also other kinds of snakes. So it's not that any kind of snake you can kill. There, like innocent living creatures. So they, if they're not doing any harm to anyone, they should be allowed to be there, and they should be make sure that they are also not hungry. But if they are poisonous and if they are dangerous, then they can be killed, and there's no, I mean, it's not sinful. Rather, it's actually a duty. It is a duty of guardians to protect those who are dependent upon them, and that may mean or has to, you know, use some violence, such as killing a dangerous creature. Krishna was doing that all the time when he was here. So many creatures came and they were dangerous for all the inhabitants of Vrindavan. So Krishna killed them. One time a great demon came in the shape of a Rishtasura, a great bull. He's like big as a mountain, isn't it? It was like his tail was, you know, it was raised up in the air. It was kind of clouds were hovering over the tail, and he was fuming and plowing up the earth with his hooves. And he was so dangerous. So what do you do when there's such a dangerous animal? But Krishna just killed him. Even if it was a bull, you know, a sacred species. But when other when a creature is dangerous for others, then it's okay that he can be killed. It's not that. Then we have to be peaceful and non-violent. No, that's against Dharma. One has a duty to protect someone who are weaker, and one doesn't protect them, then that's against Dharma. This idea of absolutely non-violence is not Vedic, it's a concoction. Gandhi had that concoction, and but that was a political thing. I'm sure Gandhi within, he had, or maybe he had some, I don't know anything about Gandhi actually. Probably you know better than I know about Gandhi. But it was a political, at least it was used as a political tool. The principle, absolute non-violence in all circumstances. And I think Gandhi was once asked, even if someone comes and kidnaps and rapes your daughter, then you remain non-violent. I said, yes, I would remain non-violent. And like that. But that's nonsense, of course. That's nonsense, and probably would not do that either. It was a political move. It was a very powerful move. He gained so much sympathy, and he was able to shake the British Empire by this political move. But it was nevertheless just politics. It's not Dharma. It's not an eternal principle. It's just politics, diplomacy, and so on. That was Gandhi's non-violence. The real Dharma is that one naturally has to protect others, then one will have to kill others for the sake of protection, and that's Dharma. Krishna says, "How is balam balava tamcha ham karma raga vivargi tam," that the strength of the strong was devoid of passion and desire. That I am. Krishna is actually present when there's someone who actually has strength and is using that strength, when he doesn't act out of lust and desire. He acts out of duty to protect those who are weaker. Krishna is personally present in that activity. This is what Dharma means. Krishna, he is present everywhere, in everything. He means everything happens by his sanction. But it's not really, his activity, his desire, that when sinful activities are going on, we're just doing our own thing. But when Dharma is being executed, it's actually Krishna who's acting in that, who's directly acting there. If it's us, we say, I am practicing Dharma, but actually Krishna's energy is directly there in the practice of Dharma. So in killing for the sake of protection, Krishna is personally present, and is not present in non-violence. So Dharma is, there's many Dharmas. There's a Dharma, say, for example, of the householder. He has to feed others if they're hungry, if there's someone who is, and then he has to feed others. But also, a snake should be fed, but snakes should also be killed if they're dangerous and like that. It's a, this way it's very intricate with dharma, how can it can be quite intricate. One has to learn it properly from authorities and like that. But just like we have nowadays, there's this big refugee issue in Europe right now. What is the dharmic thing to do? What would you say? What would you advise our great leaders according to dharma? What should they do?
In accordance to what?
Dharma.
In accordance to what?
Dharma.
No,
the refugees.
No, the refugees.
Just a practical situation. What?
Well, like Maharaj Parikshit, he gives even Kali protection when he surrenders unto him.
Mm-hmm.
So in that way, people they come and they surrender and they seek protection.
Yeah.
Then they should be given a place to stay.
Seems like this, isn't it? I mean, it's, again, it's a householder, you know, someone is hungry, just feed them. So people here, you have people who are hungry and like that. So it obviously means that they should be fed, even as a, I don't know, is it a couple million, is that even that many, is it? Some 100,000, something like that. So that would be proper dharma. And Brihamedi mentality is, no, how can they come and, you know, they're threatening our property, you know, our economical interest and like that. These are the vice versa. It would seem that dharma means that, you know, they should be taken care of. But of course that's on the mundane plane. We're not getting involved with that at all. But it seems that would be proper dharma. And
should be trained up as pure devotees.
Yeah, and then they should become pure devotees. Because otherwise you would get also implicated in karma, that, you know, okay, you didn't take care of, and there was someone who was needy at your door. Well, next time you will be needy. Next time it's you, or, you know, someone throwing bombs at your house, in your country, and you're out there. And nobody will take care of you. That's karma, that will be reciprocal. Just to, you know, dharma, if you want to follow the dharma, then at least, I mean, Krishna is personally present in the acts of dharma, and also, since one is acting according to dharma, there are no sins incurred, and one will actually, you know, well, it's pious if it's depending on the mood of the performer. If one is acting simply because it's pious and one is a fruitive worker, then one will go to heavenly planets, one will get pious results. If one is a pure devotee acting according to dharma, well, then it's not that one will go to heaven. Then one is following dharma for the pleasure of Krishna in a detached way. It's simply one is in this situation and I should follow dharma because this is Krishna's desire. I'm doing it for Krishna's satisfaction. It's called Nishkam Karma Yoga. And that's actually pure devotional service. If the consciousness is pure, if it's just done for the sake of pleasing Krishna, then it's actually form of pure devotional service. Arjuna was being asked to perform Nishkam Karma Yoga. He was being asked to fight, but fight not without any desire, you know, because you want to enjoy something. Simply, you fight for my pleasure, for my satisfaction. And this way, there's no karma incurred at all.